Okay, so I am going to start with a story, or rather a quote from a famous storyteller. So we have heard today about the importance of telling story, and so here is a quote from Virginia Woolf, which to me is a perfect way to start to tell you the story that I want to tell. And she writes in the years that there is Eleanor that is holding this cup in her hands, and she's there wondering, how is it possible that this piece of ceramic, this beautiful cup, is actually composed of atoms? How is it possible that atoms create an object? This thing for her is a marvelous mystery. Now, the what questions are classical questions in Western philosophy. So Western philosophy starts by asking, okay, what is this? What is that? What is the moon? What are the stars? And actually, this sense of asking, according to the story that Aristotle tells us, is born in a sense of wonder. So humans were wondering about the marvelous things of the world, and they are asking, okay, why is this the case? Now, as Eleanor, one of the answers that these questions can get is that things are what they are because of what they are composed of. So Eleanor is holding this cup in her hands, and she says, okay, this cup must be composed of atoms, and this is why a cup is a cup, because it has a particular physical and then chemical and then structural composition. And often, if we think about our common sense or answers that we find commonly, things are what they are because of what composes them, or some intrinsic properties, forgive me for the philosophical jargon, that means some properties that are of the object in itself. So something that somehow is unchanging, something that somehow is stable, and that we can point to. Now, this answer is often given also to the question of what biological beings are. And it's an answer that actually we find when we, for instance, think about what humans are. A common answer is that, well, humans is that species that has the genome of humans. Or a frog is a frog because it has the genome of a frog. And again, if we think about it, the intuition for which we want to answer in this way is the same that Eleanor had. That is, the cup is composed of atoms. Humans, biological things, are composed of more fundamental particles. And what are these more fundamental particles that tells us what we are? Well, the genetic code, marvelous discovery of the last century that has actually improved our understanding of the living being in a substantive way. And this has led to this way of thinking that as much as atoms compose cups and objects and molecules and elements like gold, the same is the genome for us. The genome composes us and gives us what human beings are. But what I want to do now is actually to challenge this answer and this common intuition, this common understanding of what the genome is for a biological being. And in order to do that, I would like us to look at some concrete scientific case studies that come from the study of this frog and her faraway sister. Now, there are these two frogs in the world, one that is called Xenopus levis, and if you actually Google it, you can see that it's a rather small frog with this dotted skin, and then there is this other frog, the Xenopus tropicalis, and as you might guess from the name, this other frog lives in the tropic, and is quite a chunky frog, quite a big frog with this kind of simple brown skin. Now, these two species of frogs live in different environments. One tends to live on the continent, mostly in the African continent. The other tends to live in the tropics. So we find that we have two different environments there. They have a different phenotype, they look differently, and they are a member of two different species, which also mean that they have evolved differently. What is interesting about these frogs, and why am I talking about them, if they are two different species? Now, the interesting bit is that these two frogs share a massive amount of their DNA, an incredible percentage of their DNA. And not only they share an incredible percentage of their DNA, but also they express the same genes during development. So what does it mean to express genes? It simply means that genes encode for proteins, and the same genes that encode for the same proteins in the two species are activated during development. Now, how is it possible that this leads us to two different species? And I would like you actually to have a look at this graph, and in particular to look at the middle figure over there. The numbers that you see, for instance, the GLI3 or the CFD, are individual genes that we find in the two frogs. And now forgive me again for the jargon, but I think that it's quite cool to notice that we have one species in blue and one species in green, and they are expressing the same genes, but what is the difference between them is that they express them in different quantities. So a given gene is expressed in a given amount, which means that it produces a given amount of proteins in one case, and it produces another amount of proteins in another case. These differences are so important that the two frogs actually result in being two different species. So we have our embryos that develop, and they, by starting from the same ingredients, from the same genetic code, and even more, from expressing the same clusters of genes, they lead to two different species. Why is this the case? This is the case because these genes operate in different environments. And I'm telling you this story to convey a message that actually comes from contemporary genetics and genomics, that is, the information that we find in the DNA in itself is not as informative as we would want it to be. It's not enough for us to define what a given biological species is going to be, or what a given biological individual, rather, is going to be. In order to understand that, we need to consider the context. We need to consider the place in which these interactions happen. And this is something that comes from our understanding of contemporary genetics that often talks about gene networks instead of individual genes. Or you might have heard of epigenetics, for instance, again. That is, how does genetics manifest during development? And this is something that is fundamentally dependent on the environment. So if we actually start from this case study, we can see that that picture, that individual intuitive answer that we were giving to the question, okay, what is an object? Its fundamental particles, its fundamental ingredients. What is a biological being? Its fundamental genetic properties. We can challenge this answer. We can say, well, not really. It's not that it's not important, but it doesn't give us the full picture. Now, this picture that comes from genetics, that is, relations are important, we need to consider the network or the manifestation of things, it's something that is not limited to our understanding of contemporary genetics, but is an answer that in philosophy of science, that is, that part of philosophy that tries to interpret the results of science, has been analyzed by considering other case studies. And here again, I'm presenting two examples, and here we are in the literature, indeed, in philosophy of science, one that comes from fundamental physics and one that comes from biology again. Now, according to some of our interpretations of quantum mechanics, it is quite different, or rather quite difficult, to understand what are the properties of a particle in isolation if we don't consider the context in which that particle is. So in order to consider what a quantum particle is, we need to consider the context in which it is. This result has been interpreted by some philosophers as a sign that our fundamental physical ontology, our ontology that comes from physics, is actually an ontology of relations. So fundamental particles aren't individual objects, again defined by their own properties, such as, I don't know, spin, but rather they are nodes in network of relations. And we can identify them, we can understand something about them, only in the moment in which we consider the network of relations in which they operate. And this is the school of thought that is called ontic structural realism. Now the words is like kind of wordy, but what matters here is that what they are telling us is that the world is this fundamental network of structures. Something similar in spirit comes from another reflection in the philosophy of biology that actually wants to stress that if we consider a given organism, so here we move again back to our frogs, let us say, these frogs aren't again like individual objects defined by properties that depend on them only, but rather biological entities should be conceived as processes, so as something that is fundamentally dynamic, fundamentally in exchange with the environment. And why is this the case? This is the case because a biological organism is fundamentally based on metabolism, for instance, that is an energy exchange with the environment. Without nutrition, without communication with other members of our species, we wouldn't be able to go out to continue for much longer. And evolution in itself, that is one of the fundamental things that might define life, it's something that is based on a sense of relation again, on this dynamic talk and crosstalk that there is between something and its environment. Now, let us go back to our original question. So what are objects? What are things? How can we define things? It seems that if we look at contemporary science and the reflection that we can make on contemporary science, things aren't actually simply defined but what composes them. They aren't simply defined by their particles, they aren't simply defined by some fundamental individual ingredients that are just there self-standing, but things are actually fundamentally relational. And then maybe we think about them as if they were individuals. Why? Because it's quite convenient. We abstract away the context and we consider only some parts of them that remain stable. But actually, if we want to get a full picture of what things are, we need to consider the context in which we are in. And so basically the philosophical lesson that we can take out of this is that things are what they are because they are in the relationship in which they are in. So the relationships are fundamental to the nature of things. And this is something that we might see is coming from contemporary reflection. Now, how does this relate to apex or to success or to successful people? And the next step is that there is a narrative that is quite common again, that is that success is something that an individual scientist or an individual CEO or an individual person achieves. And then we might think about, I don't know, Newton as a successful scientist. He founded a whole chunk of physics. Or we can think about, again, a CEO that you might like, or a particular powerful figure. Now, thinking of the history of ideas, thinking about people promoting ideas or being successful as if they were self-standing individual, I think is misleading. Because there is no top without bottom. There is no success without the network that allows for that success. And then when, for instance, we are considering Newton, we must not forget that Newton was operating in a particular academic environment. And so his findings, for how important they are actually dependent on the context of relations that was around him. And so my encouragement for all of you, and to wrap up this wonderful event on APEX, is to think about success as something that happens relationally, and that something that happens if we work together towards achieving it. And instead of considering ourselves as like selfish, self-standing individuals, we should consider ourselves as fundamentally relational. And I thank you all for your attention. I thank the organizers for this amazing event. I was part of the TED Talk Society during my master as well, so this event is like particularly close to my heart. So I would like me to offer a clap for all the organizers, all the people working for this event to happen.